Joyce, I have a question for you, and this may be difficult to answer. Do you believe that the spirit of your husband, Merle, haunts the Kent stage?
If anybody is there, it'll be Merle.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Popcorn and candy are a thing of the past at the Kent stage. No longer just a movie theater, the Kent stage hosts a wide range of events. As a result of these events, many of the theater's guests and employees have reported paranormal activity throughout its many years of active service. The spirit activity within the brick walls of this theater have made echoes throughout the city of Kent. Some of these experiences have been published in books, magazines, and the local news. Among all of the spirits that are thought to inhabit the historic Kent stage, none is more well known or respected than Merle Poet One Mollenkopf.
And this heart of mine tells me the dead are multiplying like the daffodils. It is a spreading stigmata.
The building was constructed in 1927 under the ownership of Flanagan and Steele Theater. In 1937, Shines Theater took over the business and continued to share motion pictures for many years. Before a feature presentation, the theater would showcase various kinds of performance acts on the stage. Not much is known regarding the specific types of performances that were conducted on the stage. Some speculate that they were musical acts or possibly short plays. Some of the claims of activity within the theater include apparitions, disembodied voices, objects moving on their own, and even physical contact. Having only just scratched the surface of what is known about the Kent stage, we decided to meet with one of the business owners, Rochelle Charlton, to learn more. Okay, I'm here with Rochelle, wife of Tom, who is one of the owners of the Kent stage. Many believe that the Kent stage is haunted, and Rochelle's here to tell us a little bit about that.
I was bringing things from the kind of the concession area through these doors down through the theater into the green room area, and on one of my trips I opened the door with kind of a handful of stuff, and as I stepped through, the sparkly lady, as we all called her, was moving pretty rapidly toward me, and we ended up colliding.
Colliding.
Yes. I felt like a giant sort of static electricity kind of shock. I was tingly everywhere.
Rochelle, what happened here?
I came into the green room area. There's a door like right here, and this door was closed at the time. And I came around and put my hand on the door to go down to the to the basement. And at that time, felt these hands on my back. It was definitely hands, and I got turned around and what I call propelled at a rather fast pace out of this room, across the stage, down, there were some steps in the front at that time, down the steps, through the theater, and out the doors to the concession area.
I gotta say, I think that if that would have happened to me, I would have left the puddle right here.
So we actually took flashlights and stuff and opened the door, and you could see water down in the tunnel area. But yeah, he had to go shut the electricity down for this part of the building in order to go down and he unplugged stuff. If I would have
gone down there,
I would have been not here anymore. I would have been passed over.
That kind of led me to a thought here. This room has some significance to it. This is the room that the theater guardian, Woody, or Albert DeVos, has passed away in.
Yes.
Do you believe that it's possible that the spirit of Woody may have saved your life, kept you from going downstairs and being electrocuted in the flooded basement? Do you
I think that's entirely a feasible explanation for that. I mean, I think that definitely
had to
have been one of the Kent stage spirits.
So we made our way down into the catering room. What has happened in this room, Rochelle?
Actually, many things have happened Laurelin had an interesting thing happen. We had a ghost hunt one night. She was down here with a pretty large group of people. And at that point in time, there was a big round table down here, and this table that was on the floor, like, literally levitated up from the floor. And Laura did, like, just to see if anybody was trying to, although it would be really hard for
one person to lift it up, kind of.
You couldn't stick your fingers under there. The whole table just slammed down on the floor.
Am I in the right spot, Rochelle?
This area is pretty interesting. A lot of people have come into contact with a little girl by the name of Alice Ann.
They leave their child spirit behind. The child spirit never dies, never changes.
So this is the famous little girl of the Kent stage, then. The one that you hear giggling and running. Who's identified her as Alice Ann?
Samantha Wilmot.
I know her.
So Alice Ann is there, very playful down there, and she sometimes shows up here at the Kent stage, and she's pretty identifiable. Sometimes you can hear her giggle.
Oh.
And then she is a tugger. She likes to tug on people to get their attention, just like a little kid would.
So Rochelle?
Yes.
This area right here holds some significance to the Kent stage as well. A lot of people, I'm told, have seen what is referred to commonly as the shadowy man.
Mm-hmm.
What can you tell me about this shadowy man?
A number of people have seen him for years, ever since we have been opened. And usually he's seen down in this area somewhere. But every once in a while, people will see him in the balcony. I've had him walk by me when I was over by the balcony one day. That was a little, like, kind of unnerving because I was doing something, and then the shadow man walks by. Laura Lynn came over here, and we were going to meet, and we were going to decide where to put different things and how to do the setup.
Okay.
And Laura was facing this direction, so I flipped the lights on, and she said, there's a man standing down by the exit sign. And I said,
right here?
No, she said, there's a man standing down there. And I said, oh, is he by the exit sign? And she said, yes. And I go, oh, that's just the shadowy man.
Nice.
And she just looked at me, and then she goes, well, let's go see. So we sat here, like, in these theater seats, and she communicated with him. He was saying that he had been part of a quartet at one time, and that his quartet used to come on Sundays once in a while and be some of the music. They used to have music or comedy or something like that right before the movies.
What presence is felt in this area where we're seated right now?
That would be Merle Mollenkopf.
But that's when he heard about the ghost walk, he said immediately,
He
had to be a part of that, and that's where he had to be.
Because Merle was, on top of everything else, Merle was a storyteller.
Yeah,
and he
was good at it.
Right, he was very good at it. He could captivate people with his stories, and he jumped at the opportunity to be a part of the Ghost Walk.
Absolutely. Every time he had an opportunity, he took it.
Merle was the very first person that was on the stage when it was the Kent stage. He opened our theater for us. He's the poet laureate of Kent.
Okay.
And he supported our theater through all of our years. He came to many shows.
That theater was as much a part of him as this house was.
If he had his own poetry show somewhere, he would talk about people should come to the Kent stage and support it. If he was on the radio for any reason, he would always mention the Kent stage. So Merle loved this theater probably as much as we did, and we feel like he is still with us at times.
Joyce, I have a question for you, and this may be difficult to answer. Do you believe that the spirit of your husband, Merle, haunts the Kent stage?
If anybody
is there. It'll be Merle. So, it would not surprise me if the next time I walk in there and sit down there by his chair, that I don't feel that he's sitting there and holding my hand, as we used to do.
After having spoke with Joyce about Merle and Rochelle and the many experiences that she and others have had, we were granted permission in order to conduct our formal paranormal investigation of the Kent stage. We placed the camera in the center of the auditorium. Then we quickly moved over to the basement in order to set up camera number 2. After that, we decided to place a camera facing toward the projection room. Next, we decided to set up a camera pointing towards the right side of the stage, with hopes of capturing a single anomaly from two positions the camera was placed to the left of the stage. Then we stationed the camera pointed at Woody's room, who is also referred to as the Theater Guardian. Making our way down into the tunnel, we immediately settled another IR camera. While below the stage, we moved over to the catering room in order to capture some of the more violent activity that has taken place at the Kent stage. And then lastly, our thermal video was set up in the general direction of seat M15. Our goal was to catch a glimpse of the legendary Merle Mullenkopf.
First heard this EVP, I got really excited. As I was leaving the stage, it appears as though a voice that I didn't hear at the time and a person I didn't see said, bye.
It's cool, man. Don't worry about it.
To me, that's excellent spirit interaction.
I think this is a beautiful case of interaction as Eric's leaving the room. I have no problem calling this a Class A EVP.
Eric leaves and he gets a spirit to say goodbye to him. Couldn't ask for anything more.
To me, it was just a real honor to have had this experience. I'll remember it for the rest of my life.
All right, so one thing I could say about the hallway is I've heard a lot of different teenagers and kids seem to run around there. So that could have been an EVP that we picked up with the girls. I'm not sure.
Our evidence review expert, Tom, did a phenomenal job of hearing this Class B EVP. We're classifying it as a Class B because we're not really sure what's being said.
This, to me, sounds like some girls in distress. I wish I could help them out.
I'm really not sure what to make of this one.
I think possibly this is a residual EVP of a woman who seems to be upset, and to me it sounds like she's starting to cry.
So strange, you just said that word. I'm hearing this song, keep yourself, what's that word, that Queen song?
It's me, sorry.
Keep yourself alive, no. That Queen song.
I don't know.
Which song?
It's like, keep yourself, let's not keep yourself alive.
Staying Alive by the Bee Gees?
No, this is Queen.
Another One Bites the Dust?
No.
That's not alive.
No.
We're the champions?
No.
Bite the Dust.
We Will Rock You? Fat Bottom Girls?
No. Who just whispered?
That's what I'm wondering. Who just whispered?
Heard that too.
Who just whispered?
Maybe I did. I might have been singing to myself.
It wasn't a singing.
No.
Bite the Dust.
We Will Rock You? Fat Bottom Girls?
No. Who just whispered?
That's what I'm wondering. Who just whispered?
Heard that too.
Who just whispered?
Maybe I did. I might have been singing to myself.
It wasn't a singing.
I don't know. I didn't whisper on purpose.
You guys heard it too?
I think I picked it up on here.
I heard it again.
Are you sure it wasn't like my lisp or something?
No, I heard it.
Okay.
In my left ear.
Okay, because I heard it too.
Yeah, I kind of really feel ridiculous getting caught singing. I don't know what I forgot that I was being filmed, but I'm really happy that it worked really well because it seemed like they just enjoy that interaction.
I'm really not sure if that was a disembodied voice or an EVP. To me, when the guy said they had heard it, I'm not sure if they heard it through their equipment or if they heard it with their own ears.
It's pretty cool, considering how really, really dumb the conversation we were having was, that we actually got some interaction, which I guess goes to show you, music transcends all planes of existence.
What a great honor to hear my name being said by the spirits here at the Kent stage. It's like being in school and having the cool kids know who you are.
But it was very clear, and it was very, a great EVP, nothing else.
So this is one of the creepier rooms in the Kent stage, and it does seem to have a host spirit that's a little bit more aggressive. I think we picked him up on this EVP.
I'm having trouble trying to...
What was that?
Yeah, what was that?
Me yawning.
No, that was like, I heard like a...
Now I just heard a whisper.
It's like, I heard like a...
I'm having trouble trying to...
What was that?
Yeah, what was that?
Me yawning.
No, that was like, I heard like a...
Now I just heard a whisper.
It's like, I heard like a... No one else heard that... type sound?
I inhale a little bit and I yawned.
And they would do that noise? No.
There was a little bit of stress in the room at that moment. And what was happening was Eric was frustrated because he really wanted to help some spirits. He wanted to interact a little bit more. And I was saying, hey, let's just talk. Let's do it. Let's work through this. This is the way to communicate with spirits.
I really just want to communicate.
Well, that's how you do it. These conversations, that's what I was talking about upstairs. That's how you get the interaction with them. Like you're doing. I think
awesome.
They appreciate that.
I mean, what can we do to help?
If they need help, they're going to say help.
Yep.
Did it get colder in here?
I get a lot of activity in this place. A lot of activity. It's a very, very interactive place. I think that you're going to be surprised how much did come through tonight.
And we did leave then, and I do believe a spirit was trying to communicate, and we left a little bit quick.
Sometimes you just gotta say it.
I guess even spirits get frustrated. Other than that, I'm not gonna touch it.
I'm really excited to do some more investigation in that room to see if they will communicate or if he will communicate again and say hello next time.
I like this EVP because I did sense a presence in the room and this gave me confirmation of that presence.
And then it did seem to cuss at us a little bit.
So if you can make the, I don't know how to do it.
You can touch its hands.
Okay, you moved it. Is that all right? I moved it?
Yeah, you're fine.
Make the, I don't know how to do it.
You can touch its hands.
Is that all right? I moved it?
Yeah, you're fine.
This EVP is really awesome, and it's kind of creepy, too.
I'm in the dark. Creepy and cool. What else can you say?
I think that one is really so cool because it's saying here, I'm gonna do this, we're gonna interact.
It's kind of cool, a little bit creepy. I hope you all enjoy going to the bathroom by yourselves later.
This is the type of EVP that I would use as a learning tool to teach a friend that doesn't know about the paranormal.
It feels very like it's gonna really reach out to us and communicate, and it did.
In this clip, you hear the REM pod kind of go off a little bit, and then right after that, I was caught off guard by what sounds like a woman's gasp. Then right after that, we hear another voice say, "I did it." And it's pretty compelling for these series of events to take place in the order that they did.
Right behind you, and it feels like a grandfather type figure. I don't know if it's your grandfather or if it's...
No, I had two on my mother's side. Or one on my mother's side and one on my... Grandpa Richard and my Grandpa Clarence.
Okay. Did you notice that the REM just went off just as a little spark a moment ago? It was right when you said the first REM.
Can you say his name again?
Richard. Everybody called him Dickie. Or Dick.
Did somebody just inhale real quick?
I don't know if I did or not. I'm sorry.
Say his name again.
Richard, everybody called him Dickie, or Dick.
Did somebody just inhale real quick?
I may have.
No, it sounded like a female. It would have been Laura. It went like that.
Did you hear it, Bobby? I don't know. I don't think I did.
Yeah, but Laura. It went like that.
Did you hear it, Bobby? I don't know. I don't think I did.
Yeah, it was startling.
I'm having trouble hearing through this. I haven't plugged in.
Bam! I did it. But I swear it wasn't me.
I really appreciate Laura doing this for me. Really meant a lot. Definitely feel the intense energy in that place.
Well, I definitely hear the sigh. And I definitely don't know who did it.
As far as the gasp and the yelling or whatever people believe they hear with this, there's something there. I can't make out what it was. But if it's yelling or any of that, would make total sense being one of my relatives, especially my grandfather, because yelling is really how we communicate in my family.
I was really enjoyed the fact that we were able to close the evening in the bar entrance area of the Kent stage. That's my favorite spot in the whole building for catching spirit activity. And to end up with those EVPs and that spirit interaction, that really put a cap on the whole evening.
So you feel that Merle would be happy with the way that he's been portrayed in the video?
Yes, he would be, yes.
And you feel pretty good about it as well?
I do, yes, I do. I think it shows the true side of Merle, who he really was. And sometimes we don't always know who people are after they're gone, but in this case, I think you have pretty much hit the mark. And I think he would be very pleased with how he was incorporated. I liked the way it was done.
Oh, yeah. Merle was very active in the community.
Well, he started going to the schools. He thought, I've got to teach these kids what poetry is all about. And so he went to the elementary schools, the middle schools, the high schools. Then he was invited to come to Kent State to talk to some of the teachers who were preparing to go into the field of teaching. And this is how you teach poetry, he would tell them. I think when I went through all his papers, I found hundreds of letters and cards and notes from kids. And some of them were written in crayon. I sat there for 2 days in that den surrounded by all these papers. And I saved some.
This is after you
passed away, yeah. But that shows you the volume of people he talked to.
Influenced.
He approved, yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm only hoping that some of these people that he influenced will one day remember, hey, I remember that guy. He's the one that introduced me to poetry and writing, creative writing, and so on. Then he'd sit there and say, now, I want you to hear this. I want to read this to you. I'm sitting over here reading a book. And he said, I want you to hear this. So he rattled it off. And, mm-hmm. Well, what do you think? I said, one time I said, Merle, what are you trying to say? I don't understand what you're trying to say here. Rewrite it. He said, well, I kind of like it. So, I was his sounding board, you know.
Okay.
Then he would say, who the heck is a poet in this house? You or me? You're the poet, I'm the critic.
There's an ominous structure in Newark, Ohio known as the Licking County Jail. Its intimidating presence in the town is likely due to the dark history surrounding this location's past. This fortress once held violent criminals and murderers such as Laura Bell Devlin, an insane woman who cut off her husband's arms and head. They were later found in her kitchen stove. Another tragic occurrence surrounds a man known as Carl Etherington. Mr. Etherington was incarcerated for shooting a man in self-defense. Later that same day, Carl was beaten in his cell, then dragged from the jail to be hung in front of the entire town. Mysteriously, four of the former sheriffs of the Licking County Jail have all died inside the building from heart attacks. The youngest sheriff to succumb to this demise was Sheriff Ross Embry, who was only 41 years old when he passed away. The amount of documented tragedies and horrific events that took place at the jail was daunting to our team. With most of the grievous history still fresh in our hearts and minds, we were ready to speak with the resident expert team United Paranormal Project to learn more before beginning our formal investigation.
You had an experience right up here.
Yes, my very first time in the building, actually.
It sounds like you need to hear about it.
Okay. One of the very first times I ever came to investigate this building, it was also one of the first times that I brought Shaq with me. And we had another group just through this door in the cell block area, and myself and another team member came in here. It was July, it was the very end of July, so, and there's no air conditioning here, it was extremely hot. When we had set up our cameras through the doorway just across the room, myself and Eric were in this area, and Shaq, he's shaking now, you can see his ears shaking a little bit. He just started shaking. It was so hot that he was so visibly upset about being in here. And I mentioned at the time, I felt like I should take him out of the room. And Eric's response was, the whole purpose to bringing him was to see
if he would be
sensitive to this kind of thing. And I needed to try and write it out a little bit. Those weren't his exact words, but we'll leave it at that.
Right.
So as he went into the other room to further investigate, I saw this area here and I thought, well, you know, this might be safe. So I kind of backed myself into the corner and the camera was shooting straight at me. I felt like I'd had enough because it just felt like something was looking, something was right here. It just, like I told you before, it's just looming.
Mm-hmm.
It was there. So Shaq and I, you can hear on the video, I always call him Shaq. So I say, you know, let's go on out of here. And about 3 or 4 seconds as we move out, you see the apparition, full body apparition, just follow us right on out of the room. When we were reviewing the video later, when Eric, I'm the biggest debunker, I will try and debunk anything first because I don't want it to be me that's happening too. So
we understand.
The first time he saw it, he literally almost fell off the stool that he was sitting on. And "Oh my gosh, you gotta see this." And he replayed it, and I said, "That's your flashlight. That's the light outside. That's my flashlight." And we slowed it down and slowed it down. And he goes, "That is not a light." And I finally had to admit that, okay, so it's not.
Because there's not very many lights mm-hmm. that look like people.
No, and it's very clearly a person. I mean, you can
almost see the lights.
You can see
moving.
Yeah, and we did screenshots too, and just
try to enhance it and look at it in more detail.
It's just not a light. It's not a light. It's a person.
Mark Orion.
Yes.
Something really cool happened in this area right here. Am I correct?
Yes, it did.
Can you tell me a little bit about it, please?
Sure. We came in just for a little private investigation, and so I was like, well, I'll go off on this side. So I came over and pulled a chair up. I sat right here in front of this window, and that night we were getting shadow activity nonstop. So I was like, I'm going to sit right here, and I was watching over there, and I was watching over here, and I started feeling really weird. Like something was around me, something was just not right. So I had Eric, who was sitting over there, take a few pictures. And before he could even go over the pictures, I was like, okay, I can't do this anymore. I gotta move.
Because you were feeling something.
Yes, definitely. And I didn't like it at all. So I ended up moving over to the other side of the room. Mm-hmm. And nobody was sitting over here at that point. And Eric got a picture of the most incredible apparition we've ever seen.
It was almost like a shadow figure.
Yeah, and it was casting a shadow, which was even weirder.
It almost implies that it was solid mass and able to cast its own shadow.
Exactly.
Where are we at now? What happened here?
We're on the second floor. Okay. So block two. Carl Etherington, who was in one of the cells just down the hall, he was a detective that was hired to clean up the town. It had been voted dry, but yet the saloon owners didn't want it to be dry, so they were fighting with the detectives. A lot of the police force was, they owned saloons. I mean, the police chief owned a saloon. So when these detectives came in, they were given the okay. They started running into conflicts. A lot of the saloons here in town. We were actually chased into, three of them were chased into a saloon, but the one saloon owner, who was a former police chief, caught Carl Etherington, one of the detectives, in an alley and started clubbing him with a nightstick.
Wow.
Carl drew his gun and shot.
In self-defense.
Yes, he didn't die. Some of the mob got to him, started beating him up. The police chief arrested Carl and brought him to the jail for safekeeping till they could figure out what the heck was going on. The person he shot was taken to a sanitarium. Later that day, the guy Carl shot died. The town found out. Mob of about 5,000 people
showed up here,
bound and determined to lynch Carl Etherington. They were going to kill him. They broke down the north door. The matron, who was the police chief's sister, fired a warning shot. The police chief grabbed her, told her let him go. Somehow the keys got into the mob's hands.
Well, I imagine you can't stop 5,000 people from getting what they want.
So they took a sledgehammer to Carl Etherington in his cell, drug him out. It's debatable whether he was actually alive when they drug him out. Took him to the town square, southeast corner, took him to a telegraph pole, hit him again with that sledgehammer, and then strung him up. That happened about 10:30 in the evening.
So they did this right in front of everybody?
Right in front of everybody, yep.
Right in the middle of town.
Right in the middle of town, yep.
And then, you know, we've just had a lot of different activity in here. There's been a black shadow seen over by the doorway over here by another fellow worker of mine for the haunt. And it scared him to death, you know, because he's seen it twice. It kind of come in the doorway and then went back and then went back again and then left real fast. He said it just made a real funny sound. We've had, when we were cleaning everything up, we've propped this door open here. My husband was also one of the ones that was helping us clean furniture and things up. I was up on the first floor running the shop back and things like that. They were doing all the heavy lifting and bringing stuff back here to the chapel area to store it. And he had this chair propped in the doorway right here because, you know, they're carrying dressers down and tables and, you know, very heavy items. And he had that propped in the doorway. Well, when he came downstairs, the door was shut, and this chair was thrown over into that room right there.
That's pretty much impossible, though,
yes.
Right?
Well, absolutely. I mean, it's not something that just got slid out of the way, or, you know, the chair's kind of heavy itself. And he immediately came upstairs and said, "Will you come upstairs and move this chair out of the doorway?" And no, I hadn't, you know, obviously, I'm not going to come down here and just move the chair out the door for
just
you.
Just for clarification, for that chair to move from here to here, something would have had to have physically moved it.
Absolutely. I mean, that's, you know, 20 feet, you know, so.
That's incredible. That's,
yeah, absolutely. But it always seems to be something around this doorway right now.
JR, you've led us to this area that's on the third floor, and you've said that you've had some shocking experience here.
Yeah, pretty much what we do, I had two other members with me at the time. I went down to set up camera facing down the hallway. As I was kneeled down to place the camera facing out, I felt as if hands were grabbing my shoulders. Not real rough, just enough to let me know they were there. I thought it was one of the members messing with me. I look over my shoulder and they're in the last cell, you know, nowhere near me. So I asked them, I was like, "Hey, is that one of you guys doing that? And they did what?" And they said they just saw the whites of my eyes kind of open up and kind of freak me out a little bit. And of course, you know, there and now for a few minutes, I was trying to think, okay, what could have possibly made me feel pretty much hands on my shoulders? And never did figure it out, but it was enough to, you know, clarify that
there's something going
on
here.
People do get touched around here. It'll get you when you least expect it. And, you know, it's always very, what's the word? You never know what you're going to get into coming through this place. So it's usually very exciting.
What room is this?
This is Mae Varner's cell.
Mae Varner? What happened to her?
She set herself on fire.
In this room or in this area, people have experienced some weird, strange activity, and they think it might be Mae. What exactly happens?
There's screams a lot. I mean, you don't even have to be on this floor to hear the screams. And it's not just a little squeal, it's a loud, piercing, like, in pain scream. And that's happened quite a few times. And a lot of guys get activity, get touched and everything on this floor, so.
That's right. I guess the men are affected in this room more so than the females, and that's one reason why we believe that this room is haunted, or the presence that is in this room is Mae.
Yeah.
There are actual female screams, probably even when no females are present, coming from this room right here. Or on this floor maybe, or just like in this room?
On this floor, in this room, I mean, it doesn't matter. You're gonna hear it regardless.
Now, having interviewed the members of United Paranormal Project, our team worked quickly with Jeff Fent to get things ready for the night's investigation. Our first camera was brought to the fourth floor cell block. Then, based on our interview with Carla Christie and her dog's reaction to being present on the third floor during our interview, we decided to place a camera pointing at an EMF trigger object that's in the form of a dog. With no hesitation, we headed to the third floor cell block, wishing to capture some of the screams that are thought to be that of Mae Varner. Quickly, Sean and Amber set up a static cam in the old sheriff's bedroom with aspiration of capturing some activity. The next camera was settled on the second floor cell block where Carl Etherington was once beaten and dragged from his cell. Moving down into the basement, we positioned a camera that is near an area where reported shadow figures and other strange activity is said to occur. Under the advisement of United Paranormal Project team member Terry, we located a camera near a door that is reported to have intense paranormal activity involving a chair. And to finish off, we arranged the thermal on the first floor so that it would be close to both Tom and the safe room.
We had set up the paranormal pooch in the matron's quarters on the third floor. What was very interesting about it is in the very beginning, the dog was sounding off by itself. And every time someone came to the door and opened the door, the dog would stop.
You could tell that Jason was getting frustrated. Every time he would go to leave the room, the dog would go off. It was hilarious.
So that was pretty funny to watch.
Went down, grabbed Terry, she came up with me. We both looked at it. We even said, make another sound, and it did.
Do you like the dog? Oh. Who supports that? Oh my God.
You like the dog, huh?
Okay, can you turn the dog off, please? Turn it off, please.
Turn off the dog.
Okay, can you touch the dog now and make it sing?
Can you touch the dog and make it sing, please? I'm just going to walk out of here. Do what you want to do. I've never experienced anything like that in my life, and still can't figure out or pinpoint what it was.
It was interesting that the dog kind of set off on its own and went on a little rampage, and for about 6 minutes kept playing its music. And just before another group came upstairs and opened the door, it had stopped. It seemed to reset itself. And as soon as they opened the door, started interacting with them again. That was totally awesome. United Paranormal Project. tried to see if they could get it to interact. And they were quite successful. They get the dog to actually, after a little coaxing, to play the sounds, the music. That was pretty cool.
We found this clip actually originally on the third floor, and then when we were trying to debunk it, it sounded louder on the second floor.
Crash. Bang. It was so loud it reverberated. I sent an email to Jeff from United Paranormal Project, and he said that he would go there the following weekend and do a sound comparison to see if we could figure out what caused that crash.
You know, slamming the doors that were there in the building and compared it to what you heard on tape. And there's really no comparison whatsoever.
No, we came in and out of that safe room all night, and that door never slammed like that. None of the doors that we came in and out of slammed like that.
What was it? Maybe something residual. Once again, probably nothing trying to directly communicate with us, but nonetheless, it's exciting.
Static camera. Second floor, cell block. Burn.
Burn is what we're hearing on this EVP. Sometimes it's very hard to tell exactly what's being said, so we do our best to try to, you know, put it out there as what we hear it as.
Yeah, it's definitely a word. The word is burn. I mean, it's a whisper, it's clear.
We just caught this Class A EVP that says burn. And you don't usually catch things like that. We can only think that it coincides with maybe May, who caught herself on fire and burned herself alive. We don't know, but it's pretty exciting for anyone in this field to catch something like that.
Now that's creepy. I was reviewing the evidence from the fourth floor static cam. And we picked up this sound. It was the sound of a woman screaming in agony.
Hearing that scream, it's very frightening, very eerie. It gave me EBGBs twice. I heard it, goosebumps. I admit I had them. It's frightening, you know, and you can't help but feel bad for that woman that actually was in pain at that time.
May Vernard is a woman who was being held for attempted suicide. And she somehow found a way to catch herself on fire to end her own life there in the jail. If this is residual from her screams, and just to imagine the pain that she inflicted upon herself. It really just hurts you. It hurts your soul.
There are two very interesting things about this clip here. The first thing is that it backs up the claims that you can hear female screams in the jail no matter where you're at.
It's not just a little squeal, it's a loud, piercing, like, in pain scream.
And then the other thing is that we captured this scream down on the third floor. It's fainter there, but that kind of validates and backs up that you can hear it from all the different floors in the building.
Hearing this blood-curdling scream that sent shivers down my spine, it would just tear you to pieces knowing that somebody would catch themselves on fire and to end their lives that way, and just to end it all, to be in that much pain and sorrow, to end their lives that way. She had to be just at her end.
It affects you. You have no choice. It affects you.
Third floor cell block. We captured this EVP on a static cam. We're not sure what this woman was trying to say. Wasn't clear enough. Definitely not Class A. Our only wish was that we could understand her better.
I guess what really matters here is we captured a true EVP, and it's some words that are being said, and it's very creepy, to say the least.
Very, very hard to discern what's being said. I don't think that we really agree on what is actually being said, but, you know, here it is for you.
So listen to this EVP as many times as you need to, and please let us know what you think that you hear.
I was doing evidence review of one of the static cameras located in the basement, right at the bottom of the stairs, and we captured an EVP on it, and it was a raspy voice calling out, "Hey, Ed."
Well, it kind of surprised us because we were all upstairs and it was between the holding cell and the chapel, so we don't know where that came from.
We always get excited when we hear a spirit call out a name because, you know, we don't know if the spirit's actually saying, "Hey, Ed," to the spirit that they see, or if they're just calling out a name residually. We just don't know, but it's exciting to think about.
This, to me, as a Class A EVP. You can't even hear it on the camera that was in the very next room. And hey, Ed, I think there's somebody that wants to talk to you.
This is my first experience with the Geo Box, and when Jeff turned it on, the first word that we heard was the name Ethan. He asked who's here with us, and we got the name Ethan.
Say, Ethan, I need to be recording this.
Billy.
What did it sound like to you?
I think it said Billy.
I don't know. I'm bad at these things.
Okay, was it Ethan? Did you say reverb?
And I remember being pretty freaked out. Like, I'm glad I'm not alone hearing all this. You know, I'm glad I was with my crew. And now going over the playback of the tape and listening to it all over again gave me the same feeling, kind of like sick to my stomach. It made me feel creeped out. I honestly wanted to kind of get out of there. is that hearing those words, like reverb, just hours after we were talking about the acoustics of the building.
So we were all standing there and we heard, "Hey guys." And then just a few seconds later, we heard this response say, "Edith."
So we're talking to, now we're talking to Edith? Edith?
And when you are sitting there in the room with that box, it just sounds creepy.
Edith then? What Edith has?
I have trouble understanding what's being said, but I do find it interesting that every time we ask a question, it seems to be responding.
Yes.
Who else is here?
Edward!
Clear as a bell.
How's it going, Edward?
Edward came through very clear as well. This is getting to be a really neat experience.
Sean happens to ask a question, and we seem to get a response to it. And definitely a Class A.
What caused the heart attacks?
Oh, no.
They may not know.
Oh, no.
They may not know.
Right?
What did he say?
Ask him again.
We got a response of no, no. Now that did not come from the geobox. That actually came out over all the noise of the geobox, almost like someone said it directly into the microphone.
No, no. They may not know.
Right? There's no way that came from the geobox. That is a Class A EVP. It is amazing.
It wasn't, you know, any of us. It didn't come from the geo box, so we don't know where it came from.
No, no. They may not know.
The group was up in the sheriff's living quarters on the second floor. They were about to come downstairs after the geo box 2 session when Amber basically dropped to her knees.
This incident caught us off guard. Just as we were leaving the room, the geobox session was over, and we thought we were going back down to the safe room to take a break. We were unpleasantly surprised.
It'll pass. It's already starting to pass.
You said a lot of tragedy happened in that room? The heart attacks?
Yep. It's one of them.
Is it one of the guys?
Yep.
I got the chills.
I did too. That's wow. What I needed. Like, I needed wow. The guys up here now.
And it's warm up here. I just got the chills all the way up my right arm and down my back.
I'm getting the chills now too.
There was a point in time when I got the chills and they ran straight through my entire body. I mean, that just showed me the validation that I needed, that what was really going on was very spiritual.
It was one of the men. It was first to start pain in my head, then sick to my stomach. Ugh. That was bad.
Are you feeling better now?
Yes.
Okay.
It's passing. I don't feel, yeah.
Amber, you sounded very sad in there too. I mean, obviously there's pain involved.
Yes.
But it seemed like there's a lot of emotion in there too.
Yeah. Because first it started in my head, like, overwhelming, like, pain and sickness. And then it just, I can't explain it. It was just like, it just overcame me and I dropped. It wasn't mine. Ugh. I'm shaking, but it passed. It was as soon as we walked out of the room, so...
I'm gonna walk right here.
What did you mean by it's not mine?
It wasn't me feeling it. When I say that it's not mine, it's not my fear, it's not my sadness, it's not my pain, it's not my sickness. It's the person's, the spirits that passed away, and it's not actually what I'm feeling, it's what they felt. I carried it out of the room with me. It'll be probably from doing the session.
You think it was Edith? The woman that you said sounded very distressed?
I don't think it was Edith. I think it was one of the men.
This experience is very frightening, and it really shows the dangers that we put ourselves in as investigators of the paranormal.
It was just terrible to watch. It was heart-wrenching to see a member of your team brought down like that by something that you could not see. It's just unbelievable.
Like that before. I've never seen anything like...
The closest thing was at that one home.
Right. And it wasn't mine then either.
No. We were at a home investigation and she got like stuck. And it was a very emotional experience for her. She actually had to leave the house for about 15, 20 minutes. So that's the only other time I've seen this.
This was pretty rough.
Yeah.
I know that I was relieved when I saw that Amber was okay after a little bit of time passed. And we were able to all walk downstairs and carry on the investigation from there.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I think that you should go take a break in the safe room.
I think so, too.
I think that's what needs to happen.
Okay.
You make it okay?
Yes.
Are you able to get up?
Okay. Yeah, I'm okay.
I'm sorry, I just couldn't see where I was grabbing. I see this arm coming at me, I'm like, uh-oh.
I was reviewing the static camera footage from the basement, and there is a system alarm that is beeping in the background. But there's also a metallic squeaking sound that's against metal, or a squeaky wheel that's being, maybe a cart that's being pulled in the basement.
Yeah, hearing that squeaking sound, wow, really boggles my mind. At first, being a musician and all, I kind of thought, hey, maybe feedback, but then closer look to it, it's impossible. It was just plugged in, it was turned on, there was no mic, there's no RF interference, nothing like that.
Possibly a residual sound, we don't know. All we know is it only got picked up on this camera, and there was nobody in the basement at the time this happened.
I reviewed this quite a few times trying to figure out what this noise could be. When I first heard it, I thought it was buttons being pushed, maybe someone trying to turn off the alarm that was sounding, but it turned out that wasn't it. We contacted Jeff Fent and Eric Glosser, and they definitely confirmed that that's a noise that they haven't heard before. So I'm still just as puzzled now as I was the first time I saw this clip.
The alarm was going off. We were on the other side of the building. And it sounds like metal on metal. In the other room, there's this fencing type stuff. It's like metal fencing. Didn't quite sound like that. Nobody knows what it is, really.
Later on in the evening, Sean made a trip up to the fourth floor and kind of worked its way down, all the way back down. He carried a camera. He was alone. It was a solo investigation. And his first stop was in the matron's quarters where we had our paranormal pooch set up.
All right, well, if you said anything, whoa, I just got the chills too. Hey, can you do me a favor? Thank you. Can you go back towards the dog and make it go off again, please?
Now, it seems as I'm walking away and out of the room into the jail, it's going off. And when I was filming, as I was trying to debunk the dog at my home, I was using my cell phone. My cell phone wasn't setting it off unless it was inches away. I really don't feel like it was me that was setting off the dog.
Didn't go off that time. Hello? Sorry for blinding you. All right, well, see, I wasn't that close to it again. Okay, so that wasn't me? Just to show you that wasn't me, can you please just do that one more time? Do it one more time and I'll leave the room. Please? Are you messing with me? See, whenever I go right here, and I got the chills again. Whenever I'm about to leave the room, it goes off.
Stop, back up, ask it a question. You know, try to explain what was going on. Try to leave again and go back off again.
Even the spirits think it's fun to mess with Sean.
I get down to the third floor cell block. And as I'm walking down the cell block, I actually feel weak in my knees. I feel like wobbling. And I actually document that as I'm walking down the hallway.
Starting to feel weak in my knees a little bit. Ooh. Hello? Is anybody here?
I'm feeling very uneasy and definitely like I am not alone.
Hello? Who's back there? Hi. What's your name? Well, thank you for letting me know you're here. Well, thank you for letting me know you're here. Okay. I think I'm gonna go.
The thing about this EVP is that we're not sure if there's actually words being spoken here. It kind of sounds like a moan, but the thing that we all agree on is that we love when we capture this type of activity.
And to me, that EVP really validates that creepy experience I had up there in the third floor.
Well, thank you for letting me know you're here.
It's something that the spirit shares with us, and we feel it's an honor to then be able to share it with everyone else.
Well, thank you for letting me know you're here.
Investigating the old Licking County Jail was a dream come true. I can't imagine going someplace else and having this much fun, getting this much activity, and just generally the experience that we had was unbeatable.
There are a lot of opportunities for everybody to learn from our experiences at the Licking County Jail. We had some very powerful experiences there, and a lot of them you can actually see what the real risks are in investigating the paranormal.
It was a lot of fun and a lot of other stuff, but things happen and you'll enjoy it. So subscribe to YouTube, our YouTube channel.
Very interesting building, a lot of history. Awesome place with awesome people that run the ghost hunts there, the United Paranormal Project. They knew that building from top to bottom, the history and everything that went along with it. When we got into the investigation, great place, a lot of activity. Some of it was really off the hook. In fact, there's so much that we could only include some of our experiences on this video. I hope you enjoy the video as much as we did making it for you.
Was that you?
And again, if you ever have the chance to visit the old Licking County Jail, don't pass it up. You'll enjoy yourself.
Important that you take a kind of a respectful approach and definitely don't provoke because of what could happen. Do you agree with that statement?
Yeah.
In a place like this.
I don't provoke. I don't want anything to happen to the people around me. I don't want anything to happen to me. I mean, I've seen it happen. I've seen provoking happen. And the person that's probably the least expecting it, sometimes even the most frail person in the group is the one that gets attacked, you know.
Because of one person's loud mouth.
Right, right. And it just creates havoc in that place for the next group of people that come in. I mean, you rile the spirits up, especially the negative ones. They tend to remember.
Our team practices a respectful approach. I want to know if you feel that it's important to kind of take that type of approach and why.
Oh, absolutely. Anytime you start an investigation, you should start with a certain approach. I mean, you don't want to come off as you're there to taunt them in any way or provoke or anything. You want them to know that you're only here to get answers and nothing else.
Because if you provoke something that, I mean, has the ability to hurt you, aren't you kind of asking for trouble at that point?
Absolutely. And then you'll probably get it too.
I just feel like it's just not good to provoke. I mean, a spirit is a spirit. They were people, you know, that's how I feel. And I just feel like if you come in and say, you know, I mean, you no harm, you know, I come in peace. That I think that's a better way to get someone to talk to you, and maybe you're helping them, you know, see the light or whatever it may be. But I feel like if there is something malevolent in a location that you're at, that kind of negative attention is going to bring that out. And I just don't think that that's what you want to do. I don't think that's safe. I don't think it's healthy.
If they were angry, upset people in life, don't ever take it for granted that they cannot be upset people in death. If they were unhappy in life, they want to make you equally unhappy because you're still living. You need to respect that. You can't ever, ever disrespect that side of it because they can make your world a living hell.
For anybody who's starting off to be an investigator and they were to visit here, what would you do if you caught somebody being disrespectful and provoking?
I tell them it's not allowed. I don't want it, you know, here. I don't want it around anybody here, me,
anybody in your group, any group coming in. I don't want her.
It's hard to find good help these days.
Yes. Bloopers.
We're classy. This is a classy show here.
Classy. Family friendly entertainment.